It's a deeply political book. It may not have set out to be political. I mean political in the deepest sense.
No,
not
it is.
Party politics.
No, I know, I know,
yeah?
I know.
You are a deeply political person. We are in an age where people pay a price for their politics. I know I read of the odd concert, the T.M. Krishna concert that gets cancelled. How often is that happening to you for taking a position on issues like the citizenship legislation, the NRC? You went to Shaheen Bagh. We are talking to you in a capital which has seen the worst, most horrific
riots that
I have seen as an adult in the city. What is the price you've had to pay for being political?
Well, the price is threats, price is cancellations, price is needing security at times.
Has that happened?
Yes, it has happened. It's happened off and on.
So death threats?
Yeah, sometimes. Not to me, but the organizer would be told that, don't have it. You're going to have it.
That's actually a more insidious way of
intimidating.
It
is. It is.
Individually, we probably would stand and stand up.
Yeah.
Threats,
but then they go to the organizer and say something. And so these things happen. But honestly, Bharka, I feel that we are so much in the public eye and so much.
We are still privileged enough,
and I would be worried about all those individuals in Delhi and Northeast Delhi today.
You went to the riot?
Yes, I went this morning.
And what are the impressions you come back with?
I mean, the horrors that it has done to everyday lives and people's homes and people's relationships and love and care and economy and social structure and social belief systems is traumatic. Schools, I mean, people. This morning there were many roads with this sweeping and trying to get some normalcy back. But everybody tells you that street is full usually, and now there are just few shops opening. And a couple of ironic things I saw, and I just couldn't get off. There's one thing I couldn't get off my mind is I went to the school that was attacked at about 4 p.m. is said, and it was closed at 1:30, and the children had gone. Went to the first floor, and it's all burnt, and on the blackboard there is a. There is Ravana, and there is Rama shooting Ravana, and it says good over evil. I mean, Bharka, I have not got over that, and that's obviously drawn the day this had happened because school is not being opened from there. And I'm saying, and then there's another sweet shop being opened in a back street with just charred homes everywhere. And there are homes that are locked and gone.
Yeah.
And you hear multiple voices. Some people are saying everybody did this, and then there was this guy who went across in a scooter who saw us entering a relief camp which was in a Muslim locality, saying, why are you going there? You must go to the Hindu locality. And he drove past us at the same time. And then you have some in a parking lot, five people talking about NRC and CA and saying they are using it as an excuse to kill us. It is so volatile.
Yeah.
But we can't run away from two things. There's nothing accidental about what happened. I think we have to say it again and again and again.
Or spontaneous.
Nothing.
Or spontaneous.
No. This is a planned thing. You create, you target a community. In this case, you target the Muslim community and then create a spiral of violence. And once you create a spiral of violence, then everybody's killing everybody. Everybody's targeting everybody. But
because Hindus have suffered as well.
Of course. That's why I'm saying. And the worst part is when we're using the word but after talking about somebody's death. I can't get over that, and we are doing this every day. Yes, somebody was killed, but I mean, how can there be a but? And now we're going to count bodies and say so many Hindu bodies and so many Muslim bodies. I mean, it's terrorizing. It is truly terrorizing. It's terrorizing to the nature of people that we are making ourselves to be.
Did you get the impression, because that is another thing that sits with me after 6 days of going to these areas every day, is the sense of a community having been orphaned. I saw neither central politicians nor Delhi politicians. I saw no politicians.
It's something I'm unable to explain because I'm shocked. They all tell you that nobody has come. Nobody has come. Whatever effort is going is because of voluntary groups doing what they can and scrambling.
Yeah.
And this is the capital city. Yeah. It is not some rural place that we normally ignore. Not that it's right. I'm just saying it out there. And the fact is no politician has come there.
Yeah.
Nobody has even said anything that matters. Nobody has said anything. It really doesn't matter what these people do in parliament. I really want to say it. I know parliament opened today and there's shouting and screaming.
Yeah.
You have not gone to the place where people are crying today that their friends have died and people have been thrown into the canal. Trains. You have no business making a show of in parliament. I'm sorry, I'm telling everybody this. Because then it becomes about you making it a show in parliament. But the fact is, you don't care. If you cared, you will first go there. You will set up camps. You will make sure there are people. You will make sure you're holding hands.
Yeah.
You're doing nothing. And you know, and most of these people are watching, I think, a lot of Hindi news. And three gentlemen came to me and said, the press have done us no favor. They have not shown what has really happened here.
We heard a lot of that.
Yeah, and they said that till 1:32 in the night, I'm waiting to see the truth.
My story.
Yeah.
It's like I met these two sisters whose brothers were pulled out from a train. Two brothers. And they said, you're not going to show our story. And I said, I will show your story. I'll send you the story after I do it. And I did. But there is that sense of being awful by media.
No, everybody. You know, and you know what's even very disturbing is when people direct you to sites where there have been horrible things. People see you walking and they know you're an outsider, right? And they stop you and say, aap kahan ja rahe hain? वहां जाइए वहां तो बहुत खराब है दैट पीपल आर सो डेस्परेट एंड सच अ सिचुएशन दैट दे वांट यू टू गो एंड सी दैट आई मीन इट शुड वी शुड बी
But you know,
weeping that this is where we are.
We should be weeping, but there is a larger problem here, which is even bigger than this riot, and that is that there is a complete breakdown of our ability to talk to each other as people across ideologies. The fact that in the backdrop of the citizenship legislation, you know, names, slogans like Desh ki gadaro ko, goli mare saalo ko were actually raised 2 days ago in the heart of the capital. Yeah. I want you to reflect a little bit on what the failure has been. Why are liberals not able to communicate? Why are we not able to make ourselves heard? Why are people not willing to accept many of the arguments? When I say people, I mean that there is a kind of populism or a nativism rather that is stoked, and it's not happening just in India, it's happening globally.
Yeah, I think that's one of the struggles of today, that it's not just happening in India and makes it much harder to have that conversation, right? Islamophobia is an international anti-immigration tendencies. The two parts to it. One is the fact that what is happening today is something that the RSS and company have been working on for the last 60, 70 years in terms of a cultural program that you need to culturally transform this land into believing a certain sense of Hindutva, which is itself a monolithic, marginalizing idea. Parallelly, this is also, we have to react and respond to whatever happens immediately. I mean, that's something you just have to do. But it is a moment that the progressive world needs to think. And I feel one of the biggest problems in the progressive discourse is an inability to engage with culture, faith, and ritual. Okay, I know it's messy. I will lay it out straight. Yes, there's discrimination, there's gender issues, there's caste issues. I know it's messy, which is why we should have been engaging with it even more. The fact is, we've allowed bigots to create a scenario where we say modern democratic India is the antithesis of civilizational India. That's the discourse we are hearing today, that 70 years of democracy is not what India is. India is in some vague antiquity, purity notion. And the reason for that is a condescension from the progressive world towards many of the, within quotes, traditional practices, which includes faith. How can we not respect faith? Faith is hope. For many people, they get up in the morning and when they pray in front of their God, it's the hope that that day will be better or something nice will happen. We have refused, you know, we can use big jargons that we, you know, we understand it aesthetically. We understand it in terms of human need. No, you have to understand it in terms of religious need.